I was a little girl, 5, 6 years old, and I was already angry at the world. Angry at the fact that I lived in a household of males, my brothers, my uncles, and my grandfather, and my mother, and the help in the house, the maids in the house, were the only women. And they had a very hard time. They had no money, they had no freedom, they had no respect, while the males had it. And I felt that it was very unfair. I felt the anger very young.
Na 1942. sticajem okolnosti u Limi u Peru, gde je njen otac bio konzul, Isabela Njende odrasta u Santiago u Čileu. Školuje se u engleskim koleđima u inostranstvu, a potom vraća u Čile. Tih godina svet se suočava sa još jednom u nizu diktatura u Latinskoj Americi. U Čileu je 1973. vojnim udarom general Pinoče zbacio s vlasti Salvadora Allendea. Zbog progona čitave porodice Allende, Isabel, bliska rođaka svrgnutog socijalističkog predsjednika, odlazi u Venecuelu, gde 1982. objavljuje svoju prvu knjigu, Kuća duhova, koja joj donosi svetsku slavu. Slede brojni romani, od kojih su kod nas najpoznatiji O ljubavi i senci, Ines srca moga, Ostravo ispod mora, Japanski ljubavnik, kao i memoarski zapisi Paula i Ishod naših dana, koji iscrtavaju njenu bogatu literarnu putanju i pozicioniraju je kao najčitaniju književnicu španskog govornog područja. Kao američka državljanka od 1993. Isabela Allende živi u San Francisku, dok njene knjige, čiji je tiraž odavno premašio 65 miliona primjeraka, putuju svetom.
Isabel, you have lived different lives in the different places on the planet. Chile, Lebanon, Bolivia, Venezuela.
Yeah.
You were born in Peru.
Yeah.
North America, Europe.
Well, I was born in Peru and my father abandoned the family when I was three. And my mother had to return with her three babies because we were 11 months apart. She had to return to her parents' house in Santiago. So it was the house of my grandparents. And at the beginning, I remember it as luminous and lovely, but my grandmother died almost immediately. And after she died, my grandfather went into a deep, deep mourning. He dressed himself in black from head to toe. He painted the furniture black. There were no desserts, no music, no parties. It was a sad childhood. It was not a happy childhood. There were the summers. In summer, we went to the beach for 2 months in the house that my grandfather had in the beach, and that was a happier time.
And your father, he was absent from your childhood, but your mother, she was a great figure.
To this day. My mother is 97 years old, and she's a huge presence in my life. She writes to me every single day. She's totally lucid. She can use the computer, she can email, she can all that. But she can't move much. She's very disabled physically.
And your close cousin is Salvador Allende, mm-hmm. ex-president of Chile. So after the military coup in 1973, after his death, it was hard for you to live in Chile.
Well, all my family left. Some were arrested. But the Allende family left the day after the coup because Mexico sent an airplane to give asylum to all these people, and they came as refugees. And of course, they called me to see if I was going to be part of it. And I thought, no, why would I leave my country? I never imagined that it would last 17 years. Everybody thought that it was a sort of historical accident. And then the military would call elections and we would go back to have a democracy. So I thought, I'll stay. But of course, I lost my job, and very rapidly I got in trouble because I was hiding people. And eventually I had to leave. But I didn't leave and go to Mexico as the rest of the family had done. I went to Venezuela.
In exile, you wrote your first book, The mm-hmm. House of the Spirits. And I like very much the story about how you wrote it.
In 1981, at the beginning of January, we got a phone call that my grandfather was dying in Chile. And so on January 8th, I started a letter for him with the idea that it was like a spiritual letter because the mail was very slow and he wouldn't receive it in time. But I kept writing. And in the letter, I wanted to tell him that I remembered everything that he had ever told me, all the anecdotes of the family, the crazy characters of my family, my grandmother, everybody. And so I kept on writing and writing every night, only at night and on the weekends. And in a year, I had 500 pages. Of course, it wasn't a letter anymore. So I finished the manuscript, sent it to Spain, because somebody said that there was an agent in Spain that might be interested. And she wrote me like a month later, or called me, I don't remember, and she said, I like your book, but everybody can write a good first book. The writer is proven on the second book. And I'm going to get your book published. And so I immediately started a second book. Well, I waited until January 8th, and I started a second book thinking of what my agent had said.
Televizija je umeđu vremenu dosađivala svojim uobičajenim programima lake muzike, takmičenja, lutrija i ljubavnih i komičnih filmova. Novine su objavljivale sportske rezultate, a dnevnik je pokazivao vrhovnog vođu zemlje dok preseca traku u neke nove bankarske centrale. Pa ipak, za nekoliko dana vest o otkriću u rudniku i fotografije leševa kružile su svetom preko teleprintera. Novinske agencije su ih se domogle i vratile ih u zemlju iz kojih su potekle, gde više nije bilo moguće skrivati skandal, uprkos cenzuri i fantastičnim izgovorima vlasti. Svi na svojim ekranima videše uštogljenog spikera koji je čitao zvaničnu verziju. Bili su to teroristi koje su pobili njihovi vlastiti sledbenici. Ali niko nije sumnjao da su to bili pobijeni politički zatvorenici.
In your second book, there is a nameless Latin American society. Why don't you name the country?
Because at the time, half of Latin America was living under a repressive military dictatorship. If not military, a very repressive dictatorship. So I wanted to write something that could have happened anywhere. The case was a Chilean case. It happened in 1978, they found the bodies of these people that had been assassinated by the police in 1973. So 5 years later, they found them in an abandoned mine. So I based the story on that event, but that event could have happened in Argentina, in Uruguay, in Brazil, anywhere.
So on one side, you write about violence, justice, politics, history. I mean that exterior world. And there is another world, inner one. There are emotions and passions and miracles and premonition, intuition. So you like very much miracles.
The influence of my grandmother when I was very little was very important in my life. And then all the stories that I heard about her. My grandmother had seances to call the spirits every, I think it was on Thursdays. And on a round big table with a very heavy foot, a Spanish heavy table that is now in my house. I can't move the table. According to the legend, my grandmother could move the table with one finger because the spirits were moving the table. So I grew up with this openness to the mystery of the world. And although I don't see spirits, I don't see ghosts.
But you say you like to live with the ghosts.
Yeah, but I live
What does it mean? So
my daughter died more than 20 years ago, 25 years ago. And I live with her. She's present in my life. Sometimes I find myself talking to her as if she was there. I don't see her, and I know that she's not a ghost that will appear in my house. But it's an exercise in memory and in love to remember her and to remember my grandmother. Now there are strange things about that, because my grandfather was a much bigger presence, because I lived with him until I was like 15. But somehow he's not a ghost in my life. He's not, my grandmother is, my mother-in-law is, my daughter, an adopted grandmother that I have. Some people stay in your memory more deeply. I don't know why.
Yeah, it's connected with love, I think.
So I don't know.
Anyway, love is your great topic.
Yes.
I think your main topic. One of your latest book, published in Serbia, is Japanese Lover. I like very much the title. I was wondering, because it wasn't Chilean Lover, Italian Lover, but why Japanese Lover?
He should have been Mexican. But what happened was that a friend of mine, we were in New York, walking in the streets of New York, and we were talking about our parents. And I was telling her that my parents are immortal. They are so old and they don't have any plans to die. And she said that her mother was 82 and she had moved into assisted living in a senior home. She had had a friend that had been close to her for more than 40 years, who was a Japanese gardener. And I said, they must be lovers. And she said, why would you say that about my mother? My mother
Why?
Was married.
Why is that?
And I said, because if I had a male friend for 40 years, I would have slept with him at least once to know how it is. She didn't like that. Well, but in any case, the Japanese gardener was a character that somehow existed in this woman's life. And I wanted to write about mature love. Is it possible to be in love or to fall in love very late in life? Also because my marriage was really failing. I had been married with my husband for many years, and it was the end of our very long marriage, and I was old. So I was also wondering what happens when love ends.
Can love endure in marriage?
It was a very particular marriage, the one that Alma has. And the love they had for each other and the friendship lasted until he died. And although he knew about the lover, but there was the special circumstances that I don't want to give away. I think that in the case of that story, the love between Alma and Ichime was an impossible love at the time, because there were all these laws that you couldn't marry interracially. Plus, they came from different backgrounds, different religion, class. And so there was no way that they could make a life together. But they were lovers all their lives. And because they were lovers, they could preserve this relationship intact and beautiful. Sometimes marriage is not good for love.
Školovanje je prošla sama. Putovala je i radila sama. Nije imala kolege ni drugove, samo podređene. Za sve to je našla zamenu u opsesivnoj ljubavi prema Ishimeju Fukudi i ekskluzivnom prijateljstvu s Natanielom Belaskom, kojeg se nije sećala kao supruga, već kao svog najprisnijeg prijatelja. U posljednjoj etapi svog života imala je Ishimeja, svog legendarnog ljubavnika, svog unuka Seta i Irinu, Lenija i Keti, najpribližnije pojmu prijatelja koje je imala unazad nekoliko godina. Zahvaljujući njima, bila je oslobođena dosade, jedne od najvećih muka starosti.
I can feel your passion in every character you write about. So as you could presume, I adore your female characters.
Oh.
They are very strong, that they are sometimes too strong.
I think that really I don't know weak women. And if I get to know one, it wouldn't be interesting for a book. You write about extraordinary people, extraordinary events, extraordinary stories, at least in my books. I'm always looking for what is extraordinary. That is possible. Of course it's possible. And like the case of this old woman with a Japanese gardener, I know the person. I have met her many times. And I love the story. Now, the same woman, without the lover, there is no story.
But let's go back to the male characters. Mm-hmm. Somehow they are incomplete. They're always missing something. There is always an empty place inside them.
A story is something that changes, that evolves. If there is no change, there is no story. If there is nothing missing, then how can you move in the story? Women might be looking for love, or they might have been traumatized and they have to get over it, or they have suffered violence and they have to overcome the violence. So there is always something missing. And in men, in my male characters, there is always something missing also. But they are as incomplete as we all are. I don't find them weak. I find that my focus is on women always, because I think they are more connected to emotions than men and to relationships. And my books are about relationships. Yeah. Even the historical novels. I have written several historical novels in which, of course, the historical event is essential to the book, like in Inés of My Soul or The Island Beneath the Sea, which is the slave revolt in Haiti 200 years ago. That is the historical event. But how can I tell that story if I don't pick up people and I don't follow the people's lives? That's what interests me.
No matter what you're writing about, there's always the same ingredients in every story.
Yeah.
History, politics, adventures, long journeys, exotic places. But every time you blend it on a different way.
I don't have a formula. All the books are different. My own experience, my memories and my obsessions, the things that interest me, are present in the books. There is always an element of justice. There is an element of compassion also, that people can forgive. There is redemption. Because that has been the experience in my life. If you carry with you bad feelings, bad memories, revenge, hatred, it's a terrible burden. You have to get rid of all that in order to walk your journey in life.
Živim u okrugu Marin, severno od San Franciska. 20 milja od mosta Golden Gate među brežuljcima zlatno-žute boje leti, a smaragdne zimi, na zapadnoj obali ogromnog zaliva. Sinoć nisam mogla da zaspim. Oluja je udarila na nas, vetar je zavijao među hrastovima šibajući prozore na kući. Ali ni ta apokaliptična vetruština, ni dobovanje grada po krovovima nije mi te noći oduzelo san. Već strepnja zbog neminovnog svanjivanja 8. januara. Već 25 godina uvek počinjem da pišem na taj dan. Više iz sujeverja nego iz discipline. Plašim se da će knjiga, ako je započnem nekog drugog dana, biti čist promašaj i da, ako dozvolim da prođe 8. januara, da ne napišem ni jedan redak, više to neću moći da učinim cele godine.
You write the books of fiction and the books of non-fiction, and you wrote two memoirs about your daughter Paola. So, did you write it to overcome the grief? And was it hard to expose yourself and your family?
No. When I wrote the book, I wasn't planning to publish it. Paola died December 6, 1992. And I started my books a few weeks later. And my mother said, "What are you going to write on January 8th? And I said, "Nothing. I'm just, what are you talking about? I can't even think about that." And my mother said, "If you don't write, you'll go crazy. You have to write." And she gave me back 180 letters that I had sent her during that time. And she said, "Read them. They are in chronological order so that you will understand what happened to Paola and you will accept that the only way out was death. It's a liberation for her." So for me, the whole year had been one big night. I couldn't differentiate one day from the other. But when I started reading the letters, I saw the process. I saw that it started in Spain, that I brought her to the United States, the hospital, and then the house, and then when she died, then I could see the whole year. And I started writing according to the order in those letters. And it got mixed up with memories of the family, of the old, because the book had started, the notes I had taken had started in Spain when everybody told me that Paula was going to wake up. So I started taking notes about all the things I was going to tell her, because they also told me that probably she would have lapse of memory. So I wanted to tell her what her life was like and where she came from. That was the first part of the book. And then when finally I realized that there was no way that she would wake up ever, then it was a different second part. I was not talking to her anymore. When I finished the book, I felt that I understood what had happened, I had accepted it, and I went through the first year of pain that was the worst. So that helped me a lot.
Juan iz Malage je bio mrtav, a ja sam bila slobodna. Mogu sa sigurnošću da tvrdim da je toga dana počeo moj život. Godine koje su prethodile samo su bile uvod i priprema za ono što će uslediti. Moj život je pre toga bio život jedne beznačajne krojačice iz Plasencije, poput stotine i stotine radnica pre i posle mene. S Pedrom de Valdivijom sam doživjela legendarnu ljubav i s njim sam osvojila jedno carstvo. Iako sam obožavala Rodriga de Quirogu, tvog oca, i živela s njim 30 godina, moj život vredi ispričati samo zbog osvajanja Čilea. Iskustva koje sam podelila s Pedrom de Valdivijom.
You're a feminist since your youth, I think.
Yes, I've always been a feminist.
In Chile, in Latin America, in the 60s and 70s, there was a slogan, feminism, socialism and much more.
It didn't work that way.
No.
Socialism was equality for everybody except the women. In theory, we were all equal and we were fighting for the people. But somehow the people did not include the women, because when it came to real life, women were still serving men and men had all the advantages. So it wasn't as if it was tied, maybe theoretically, but not really.
But were you socialist?
I wasn't very much into politics at the time. I voted for Allende and I was more of the left, but I wasn't in the Socialist Party.
You live in San Francisco, America. You're an American citizen. Do you feel American?
No, I don't.
No?
I don't feel American, but I like this country. Well, now with Trump, I don't like it that much. But this country has been very generous with me. Here I have had space and respect, and all my books have been published. And I have had my kids come here, my grandkids were born here. So it's been my home for 30 years. However, I speak English with an accent. I don't quite belong. I'm always a foreigner everywhere. I belong to what they call minority, so I'm in one of the minorities.
But as a writer, you're a minority.
Also.
Yes, also yes.
As a short person,
yeah.
I'm also
no.
married. Yeah. And I go back to Chile, and the first week I always feel this is my place, because I understand the irony, the subtleties of the language, of life, you know. Even the country has changed so much, I still feel that I belong. And then 2 weeks into my stay in Chile, I don't belong anymore. Because I have changed a lot, the country has changed. And I miss what I have here. My house, my dog, my kids, my friends, everybody's here. I have a foot there and a foot here and I travel all the time.
But you're always in between.
Yeah.
It's a good for a writer.
Yeah, it's good not to belong, because yes. if you don't belong in a place, you have to be very observant, be attentive, aware of everything around you. You don't take anything for granted, which is good for a writer.
But in fact, you're an immigrant.
Yeah.
In a country which is a country of immigrants.
Immigrants.
Yes.
No country likes immigrants at the beginning. When all the waves of immigration that we have had in the United States have been received with hostility. The Italians, the Jews, the Irish, the Scandinavians, everybody has been badly received. And then they integrate themselves into the society and their children belong and it's over and they are part of the society. It's much harder when you can identify them in the street, the Chinese. To this day, now the Chinese are respected because the best students in the university and the best scientists and everybody in technology is Asian. But the Chinese had a very hard time for a long time. The Japanese also at the beginning. And now, of course, the Latinos, because everybody can tell who is a Latino. So when there's race involved, then there's more hostility.
Are you critical about what happens in America?
Of course I am. Of course I am. This is a country that has evolved and sustained itself on certain values. And under the surface, there is a lot going on that we don't want to acknowledge. Racism, xenophobia, misogynia, the nationalism, all that is there like it is in every country. And given the wrong circumstances, it emerges. And the problem of race in this country, no one wants to tackle it because they think that after the civil movements of the 60s, race has been overcome. It's not true. And having a black president did not end racism. It probably made it worse. Because Trump is a reaction to Obama. And all these white supremacists and the Ku Klux Klan and all this has emerged because of Trump and his presidency allows it, encourages it, but it's always there. He doesn't invent anything. He just represents something that is there. And for me as an American citizen and someone who lives here, it's very painful because I realize that in any society, you can have fascism. You can have anything, anywhere. We are not safe from that.
I would like to go back to your writing. Mm-hmm. I would like to ask you something about your new book.
Yeah. My new book is called In the Midst of Winter. And there is a line by Albert Camus that gave me the idea for the book. And the quote says, in the midst of winter, I found within me an invincible summer. Yeah. The idea that we all go through winters in our lives. Some winters are very long and very hard. But there is always the possibility of an invincible summer under the surface that we can bring out with an open heart, with willingness to take risks, that can come up. And I have seen that in my life. I have gone through long winters and I have always found the summer. But it also happens to nations. When we went through the long winter of the dictatorship in Chile, 17 years, I thought there was no way out. And then when democracy came back, it came back stronger than ever. Because now we know what we can lose. So we are very careful. So the book happens in Brooklyn last year, in January, during a snow blizzard, a snowstorm. It's a very contained story. But each one of these characters has a background, has a life. So that opens up the book to the past. And they are all living in a moment of winter in their lives. Not only the physical winter of the storm, but the inner winter in which they are sort of stuck. And by opting for solidarity and compassion, they find friendship and they find love, adventure, and the invincible summer that they had inside. So that's the story.
And do you feel that summer inside yourself?
Of course. Yeah. Because when I was writing the book, when I was writing, began the book, I was separated from Willie. I had bought this little house where I live now with my dog. And my life was very contained. And some, I wouldn't say it was winter, but it was, there was no summer. And then in the process of writing the book and during the year, I found a man who loves me. I found the summer. And now this man, who is 74 years old, sold his house and came to live with me with 10 small boxes. that's all his past life is in those 10 boxes. So it's a cute story.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Oh,
I wish you a lot of nice, beautiful, invisible summers.
Thank you. Thank you so much. The same to you.
Thank you.
And to you, of course.
Thank you.